Alright everyone, welcome back to more Umineko. We're finally starting a brand new chapter or episode, and now I'm even more looking forward to seeing how this one will go. A lot of things always change in each episode, and we're always getting a different type of perspective. And this time I'm fairly certain we're going to get some from Angie's side as well, and I'm looking forward to that the most. So if anything else, I hope you all continue to enjoy. Thank you all for the love and support. Let's do this. Alright everyone, welcome back.
正式に招待状を送り、この席へ招かせていただいた。ロノウェ、客人を呼べ。
その必要はないわ。もういるわよ。
The voice that answered Bieto's call came from the darkness in the corner of the room. Battler turned around in surprise to discover that the mysterious woman was suddenly there.
おやおや。そなたも人が悪い。来ていたならば、挨拶の一つもすればよいもの
を。私、殴る前に挨拶する習慣ないの。でも、殴り終わってからならしてあげるわ。
ほう、なんとする？
Good night, have a nice dream.
Laughter, 実に笑える。
Bieto cackled and clapped her hands. But that was only Bieto, and nothing rose to Battler's face except an uncertain smile.
あんた、武闘派だな。
Battler met eyes with the woman, shrugging his shoulders as he spoke. But the woman didn't answer, giving only a cold stare in return.
前回は土壇場で世話になったな。礼を言うぜ。
礼なんていらない。あなたがぶったるんでただけよ。私は目を覚ませと言っただけ。
そうだな。バトラはぶったるんでるな。
Bieto tried to laugh in agreement, but the woman wasn't listening. She did absolutely nothing except stare at Battler with ice cold eyes.
どうやら、俺は嫌われてるみてえだな。
あなたが本気で戦ってないからイラついてるだけよ。
俺が本気じゃないだと？
まさか、あの低たらくが本気だったとでも？バカにしないで。いつまでこんな魔女の茶番に付き合ってるつもりなの？
俺は俺なりにベアトと戦ってる。もちろん本気でだ。
本気で？笑わせないで。魔女といつまでも永遠にお茶を飲んで談笑しているだけのあなたが本気で戦っている？冗談は髪型だけにして。
そりゃ俺も最初はこの魔女のゲームに不慣れで散々な目に遭わされてきたさ。だがな、ようやく戦い方やそのコツが見えてきたところだ。俺のこれまでの無様さがあんたには本気でないように見えたのなら、それは誤りだぜ。
そう？
確かに、俺がベアトの胸ぐらをつかみ上げるのに必要な距離は、まだかなりあるだろうと思う。しかしその距離は、どれほど長大であろうとも有限だ。そして俺は、ゲームを重ねるごとに、一歩一歩確実にその距離を詰めている。時間はかかろうとも、あの魔女を追い詰め、必ずチェックメイトする。それには、奴がよく口にするように、千年をかけるかもしれねえ。だが、それでもいつか必ず打ち勝つ。なぜか、俺が絶対に負けを認めないからだ。絶対に立ち止まらない。追い詰め続ける。だからつまり、言えることはただ一つ。俺はいつか必ず、あの魔女に勝つってことだ。
気の長い話ね。あなた勝つ気あるの？有限も、その扱いを間違えれば無限と化す。今のあなたはすでに、亀すら追い越せないアキレスなのよ。なるほどね。私が必要なわけだわ。こんなざまじゃ、何億年をかけようとも、無限の魔女に勝てるわけがない。
お前は何者なんだ。名前くらい聞かせてくれたって、罰は当たらねえだろ。
Oh, you can tell she wants to tell him. But you can tell she's also a little hurt that he doesn't recognize her. But you can't blame Batlet for that. Who's gonna believe that she came from the future?At that point, the woman fell silent, gazing straight into Battler's eyes. At first, Battler faltered under the firmness of that look and his gaze wavered slightly. But as her eyes continued to stare into his gradually, he found himself becoming lost in them. And in their depths, he saw a light that he had seen at some time before. Battler was struck by how strongly they resembled the eyes of a girl who definitely couldn't be here. Oh, maybe sensing her. But that was completely impossible.
そんなバカなとは思うんだが、なぜか、そんな気がするんだ。でもそんなことあるわけがない。まだ、あいつは6歳のはずだ。
Oh, so he can sense her. Wow. Good on him.
お前、まさか、エンジェ、なのか。
そうだ。と言ったら、あなたは信じるの?
うん。
言い方を変えるわ。私はあなたの味方よ。だから信用して。と言ったら、あなたは信じるの?初対面の正体不明の女が、自分の知人になんとなく似ているからという理由だけで、あなたは無条件に信用してしまうの?
Well, she neither confirmed nor denied it, but she does bring up a very valid point.
そんなお人よしだから、前回のゲームであっさり騙されて、悔し涙をボロボロこぼすことになるのよ。
That difference is, she is actually on his side, though.
あなた、自分で言ったわ。その子は6歳なんでしょ?私が6歳に見える?にもかかわらず、私がその子だと自称したなら、それを鵜呑みにするの?
それを言われると、弱えな。すまん。そうだな。俺はお人よしだ。そいつを前回のゲームで思い知らされたはずなのにな。
Technically, she's still helping him. Even now. She's basically trying to tell him to keep his guard up.
お前が言う、俺が本気じゃないってのは、そういう意味か。
そうよ。あなたは魔女と戦っているつもりでしょうけど。ただ慣れ合って遊んでいるだけ。チェスで仲良く戦って遊んでいるだけなのよ。あなたたちにとってそれは真剣勝負でしょうけれど、それを離れて見ている私には仲良くルールに守られて、ただ遊んでいるようにしか見えない。
きついな。
でも、その大遊びに勝てない限り、あなたはここから解放されない。だから私が来たのよ。このゲームに決着をつけるためにね。今のあなたは、魔女を追い詰めていると称しながら、車輪の中を延々と走り続けるハムスターみたいなもの。
あれか。夜な夜なくるくると車輪の中を走り続けるあれか。
車輪の中を走り続けることは一見、無限のように思えるかもしれない。無限の魔女ベアトリーチェ。まるであなたのことね。そして、その車輪の中で戦ってるつもりで滑稽にいつまでも走り続けているのが彼。これはゲームじゃない。彼を永遠に閉じ込めているだけのカゴでしかない。
ほう、わらわの無限を。ネズミが遊ぶ車輪風情に呼ばわるか。面白い面白い。
ある次元における無限は、より高次元において無限をなさないものよ。メンガーのスポンジが無限の表面積を持つのは3次元未満の世界での話。3次元の現実においては質量ゼロ。無限どころか、存在さえできない。
威勢のいい女よ。わらわの敵を名乗る程度の資格はあるらしい。
あんた、何者なんだ？
私はあなたの味方。そして魔女の敵よ。もちろん、信じなくていい。私が本当にあなたの味方であるかなんて、誰にむしろ、私のことをうさんくさいと思うくらいの警戒心の方が望ましいわ。
そうだな。前回、ひでえ目に遭わされたんだ。そのくらいの用心深さは必要だな。俺も、もう二度と騙されるのはごめんだぜ。
Beata laughed with true satisfaction in a way that was insulting only to Battler.
人はいきなり騙されたりはしない。自らの確認を怠り、それを他人に委ねたとき、騙される。他の人が渡り始めたから、もう信号は青になったと思った。じゃあ、事故の言い訳にはならないってこと。わかる？
ああ、わかるぜ。与えられた情報を鵜呑みにするんじゃなく、自分の頭で考えろってことだろ？俺はベアトに見せられた魔法を鵜呑みにしていた。考えることをやめていた。だからダメだったんだ。
Battler grimaced as he remembered his many painful losses. Seeing that, the witch laughed audaciously once again.
私はあなたが有利になるように助言する。もちろん、あなたは私のそれを鵜呑みにすべきではない。
So contradicting.
私が味方であることの絶対の保証なんて、誰にもできないのだから。
In the last game, Virgilia, who I thought was an ally, turned out to be on the witch's side after all.Battler couldn't get that eerie smile worn by Virgilia, who he had even thought of as a dependable out of his head.
だから、私を無条件で信用なんてしなくていい。
But she would love it if he did.
故に、私の助言も参考意見程度にとどめてもらって大いに結構。
That is very fair.
だって、魔女とのゲームを戦っているプレイヤーは、あなたなんだから。
そうだな。外野の差し手に従って打ったから負けた。なんて、情けねえ言い訳だもんな。
そうとも。わらわの相手はバトラよ。そなたなど、外野に過ぎぬわ。それをわきまえているとは良いことだ。
いいえ、外野じゃないわ。レアトリーチェと後ろ宮バトラ。そして、それを俯瞰する私が、まるで三角形のような形になって戦うのよ。一見、これは共闘ではないけれど、一緒に戦うばかりが共闘ではない。
ほう、珍妙なことを言い出す。
さっき彼は戦うことを、あなたとの距離を詰めると表現した。でも、一つの目では距離は測れない。二つの目があって初めて物事は立体的に見え、その距離も測れる。そして、二つの視点があっても、同じ場所からでは意味がない。離れている方が、魔女を正確に測ることができる。
異なる立場から、異なる角度で撃つ。十字砲火ってことだな。面白いぜ。
異なる立場から、異なる角度で撃つ。だから私は誰とも慣れ合わない。自分の立ち位置をずらし、魔女を挟み撃ちにするために。
いいのか、バトラー。その女は実は、わらわが差し向けた伏兵かもしれぬぞ。もっともらしいことを言って、そなたを信用させようとしているだけかもしれぬぞ。
かもな。こいつは、さっきからそれをずっと重ねていっている。だからこいつの助言は、もちろん鵜呑みになんかできないだろうさ。だが、それが信用に値するものか否か、俺は俺が自ら考えることをやめない限り、俺はもう誰にも騙されない。
大した自信だぞ、後ろ宮バトラ。そこまで言い切ったそなたをコロリと。また騙してみたいぞ。 そして再び騙されたことを知った時のそなたがどんな顔を浮かべるのか、わらわは見てみたい。気に入った。
なあ、あんたは俺の名を知ってるようだが、俺はあんたの名を知らない。名前を聞かせてくれ。
For a while, the woman remained silent without the slightest change in her expression. She looked as though she couldn't decide whether to say her name or not, or possibly as though she was deciding what to call herself on the spot.
Gretel.
Wow.
Gretel?
Gretel. Gretel.
お前がか？
バカね、名前よ。私のことはグレーテルと呼んで。
じゃあ、俺はヘンゼルとでも名乗った方がいいか？冗談さ。俺は後ろ宮バトラ。バトラと呼んでくれ。
よろしく。握手は嫌い。気を悪くしないでね。
そうだな。悪い。お前が味方と決まったわけじゃないしな。警戒心を持てって言われたばかりなのにな。
Ballard drew back the right hand he had stuck out. His bitter smile disappeared and was replaced with a strong expression of resolve for the new game now in its fourth iteration.
バトラ、あなたはどうして魔女に勝たなければならないのか、よく考えて。気に入らないからやっつけるなんて抽象的なものではダメ。絶対に魔女を打ち倒して、この世界から抜け出すという強い信念を持って。あなたの帰りを待っている人が必ずいるから。その子のためにも。
Maybe she had said something on her mind. Gretel clenched a fist in front of her chest and hung her head in silence at a loss for words for a short while. Bieto spoke up in a forceful voice, shattering that silence.
よし、これにてグレーテルとやらの自己紹介も十分であろう。さあさあ思い出してごらんなさい。10月4日に何があったのか。第4のゲームの幕開けであるぞ。
In unison with her voice, the clock which had been turned back to October 4th, 1986 started to move, as though blown by a sudden raging storm.While we remained in the witch's tea room, the blue-gray sea and the green Rokenjima spread out beneath us, and we could see the boat heading there, trailing a wake behind it. The sky was already cloudy, and it seemed that the barrier of the typhoon would soon shut the island away. The boat docked in the harbor, and Goda, who had been waiting there, could be seen helping to unload it.And finally, the boat dropped off all of the passengers and began to separate from the island. The relatives started to get swallowed up by the island.
マリアは相変わらず元気だな。
マリアちゃん、気をつけないと転ぶよ。気をつけて。
落ちる落ちる、沈む沈む。
All my fondly remembered cousins I had loved so much dashed away to the beach, disappearing as they were sucked into the forest path leading to the mansion. And of course, Oni-chan could be seen among them too.
くそー！待て待て、マリア！こんな、すばしっこいやつ！
Maria Onet-chan, who I had loved, dashed away, and Oni-chan chased after her. They were swallowed up by the forest. Following in pursuit, Mom and Dad were also swallowed up. The rest of my relatives were swallowed up too. Swallowed up, leaving only me behind.
Baka, いつまでこんなところで魔女と戯れて遊んでいるのよ。早く帰ってきてよ。お兄ちゃん、私を一人ぼっちにしないで。そして気がついて、残された私がどれだけ辛く寂しい世界で ごきげんよう。ごきげんよう。
Good day to you is the standard greeting used here. No matter how many years pass by, this style of greeting still feels very awkward. I have responded to the greeting in order to stifle that awkward feeling. But the classmate who had spoken looked at me blankly.
え?え?なになに?違うわよね。
Their choice of words and manner were certainly what you would expect of a school for rich girls. But at their core, they were as innocent and cruel as any children of that age. It seems they found it funny that I had mistakenly thought the greeting had been directed at me. No, it might be the opposite. Maybe I should say that they didn't know what to do after being greeted by an introverted kid like me. No, judging by the looks of my classmates glancing this way over their shoulders and whispering to each other,There were even some who seemed to consider the refreshing morning ruined. I am depressing, because no one likes me. So trying not to get in the way of everyone's refreshing morning anymore, I entered the classroom in a low crouch. Almost like I was cutting across the aisle in a movie theater while the movie was running. This is an all-dorm academy called St. Lucia Academy. Lucia? Lucia. It's not a school that just anyone can get into simply by passing a test.It's a hidden rich girl school known only to a select group of celebrities from various circles. For lofty nobles who truly wish their daughters to be brought up like saints, this is probably the ideal academy in which to protect them from the impurities of the common world. But at the same time, it was probably also a convenient place for nobles to confine daughters who they didn't want the public to know about. As well as an academy isolated from impurities of the common world, it also held excellent potential as a prison school. Wow.Eva really went through a lot of effort to make sure that her niece was miserable. I was truly among the latter and spent my days confined in St. Lucia Academy. As the weeks, months, and years dragged on at a mind-numbing pace. Of course, there weren't that many students like me, and you couldn't tell us apart at a glance. However, even if they didn't come forward, you could usually guess from their appearance.Because they were always hanging their heads all the time, with an expression on their faces as though the whole world had abandoned them.And every class had one or two kids like that, so even if they didn't speak up about it, you could guess who they were. So, even though I never confessed that I was one of those kids, at some point, everyone in class knew. Just like how the seriousness of your injury grants you status in a hospital room, here, status is granted by the nobility of your birth. Those who aren't permitted to go out in public are probably nothing more than filth to them. They must think that getting involved with students like that would dirty them as well.Whenever such a rumor sprang up about a particular student, those fastidious girls would about-face and grow cold and distant, chasing that student out of all possible social groups. I have that to thank for this quiet and solitary school life of mine. Well, that's only if hearing people whisper behind my back, finding my things lost or broken all the time, and having everyone pretend like they don't know anything about it can be called a quiet school life.I must be wearing a wary expression already this morning. I can understand completely why my other classmates who had been enjoying a refreshing morning would want to click their tongues upon seeing it. Consciously trying to do my best to avoid tainting my classmates' morning, I quietly took my seat. Then, unusually, someone came to talk to me. It was the class leader.
ごきげんよう、白宮さん。朝からご機嫌斜めなご様子ね。ちゃんと睡眠は取られてる?
何かご用ですか?
学年発表会のアンケート、まだ提出してないの、後宮さんだけよ。昨日までが提出日だったの、お忘れ?
I'm pretty sure I heard something about that sometime last week, but I think the questionnaire hadn't been passed out yet. All the necessary information would be written on that, so it should have been no problem to forget about it until it was handed out.
アンケート用紙、もらってないですけど。
そんなはずありませんよ。寮長から全員に。ちゃんと配布されてるはずです。なくしてしまったならそうと素直におっしゃればいいのに。
なくしました。今すぐ書きますから。用紙をいただけますか?
Again, either someone lost my paper or they intentionally didn't tell me about it. But I have no way of knowing who was behind that. In the end, treating it as though it was my own carelessness would settle everything more quickly and without any drama.
書いたらご自身で生徒会室のアンケートポストに投函されるように。うちのクラスだけですよ。昨夜までに全員のが揃わなかったのは。
As I hung my head at the class leader's scolding, I could hear the giggles and whispers of people watching coming from no direction in particular. Ushiro Miya-san did it again, because she never concentrates. She's unsuitable for this school. She has neither class nor manners. Sorry girls, but I've dealt with much worse when it comes to unfair personal attacks. I froze my heart and let those arrows of ridicule pass by as I quickly filled out the questionnaire.When I heard the news that Mom, Dad, Oni-chan, and all the rest of my family had died, I was in the house of my grandpa on my mom's side. The only survivor of the accident was Ushinomiya Eva. Only Aunt Eva. Even at that time, I hadn't really liked Aunt Eva. At a glance, she seemed to act kindly to me. But even as young as I was, I could see clearly that she was somehow belittling Dad and the rest, and I didn't like it. So when it was decided that Aunt Eva would take care of me, I was pretty miserable.It wouldn't have mattered if my nice uncle Hideyoshi and George Oni-chan could have been there too. But I hated the thought of living all alone with Aunt Eva. I had an honest talk with Grandpa about that, hoping that I could live with him. However, Aunt Eva was very insistent that she should be the one to look after me. Aunt Eva had no desire to remarry, so she said I was essential for the succession of the Ushinomiya family. Aunt Eva felt strongly about the house of Ushinomiya.She firmly demanded to take charge of me right away so that she could give me an education and lifestyle fitting for the successor. Complicated negotiations with lawyers apparently took place. But in the end, I was forced to go live with Aunt Eva. After she took me in, Aunt Eva told me something. You must bear all of the glory and history of the Ushinomiya family. And in order to make you a fitting successor to bear that, your life from now on will be dedicated to studying like hell.Sacrifice the rest of your life for the Ushinomiya family. She was definitive about it. At first, I thought she meant exactly what she said, but I quickly realized that wasn't the case. Because even then, in Aunt Eva's eyes, the one most fitting to be successor was George Oni-chan, who had passed away. At my first meal, I was strictly instructed and interrogated about my table manners.And was forced to listen to her disparage Mom and Dad as though they had been neglectful of my upbringing. I also received the same strict instructions regarding manners in my first party, and I was insulted in public for my clumsiness and forced to endure insults to Mom and Dad as well. After that happened enough times, I finally came to understand. Aunt Eva didn't really want to make me the successor. She thought that the one who was truly fitting to be the successor was George Oni-chan, and she couldn't forgive the fact that it was going to be me.So I was disparaged in front of a lot of people, humiliated, and she made it known far and wide exactly how inferior I was to George Oni-chan, surely in memory of her dead son. No, she must still have been mourning his death. However, that wasn't something I could endure. I couldn't possibly live together without Aunt Eva. I would be eternally suffocated, continually compared with her dead son. Even as an elementary schooler, I understood that.I ran away from the house of Ushinomiya and tried to go to my grandpa's house. However, Aunt Eva had already foreseen that. No, thinking back on it, she might have been luring me into escaping. I was caught by the guards and brought back. And for being a coward who had disgraced the Ushinomiya family crest and attempted to abandon the Ushinomiya name, I was punished in a way that makes my whole body shake and shiver just remembering it. How should I describe what Aunt Eva was like when she punished me?Frenzied? Gleeful? The anger and sadness of losing her beloved son and, well, as her hatred and pain towards the fact that I was going to steal the headship her son was meant to inherit. And the dark pleasure of being able to let those feelings out on me. I was pummeled with all those negative emotions at once. Alright guys, I'm going to end the video here for today. Thank you all for watching. When we come back, we're going to continue on with Angie's flashback.